Good morning, sisters and brothers in Christ. Welcome to this morning's worship. We begin our service with the intro hymn, CPWI 246. All hail the power of Jesus' name.
Since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive and find grace to help in time of need. That we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Blessed be God, Father, Son,
and Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia. The Father of purity. Almighty God, you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets happen. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The following is the Psalm on page 181, proper 29, page 181. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, whose will it is to restore all things in your word without Son, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, mercifully grant that the peoples of the earth, divided and enslaved by sin, may be free and brought together under his most gracious rule, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we sit for the ministry of the Lord.
Now these are the last words of David, the oracle of David, son of Jesse, the oracle of the man whom God exalted, the anointed of the God of Jacob, the favorite of the strong one of Israel. The Spirit of the Lord speaks through me. His word is upon my tongue. The God of Israel has spoken. The Rock of Israel has said to me, one who rules over people justly, ruling in the fear of God, is like the light of the morning, like the sun rising on a cloudless morning, gleaming from the rain on the grassy land. Is not my house like this with God? For he has made with me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things and secure. Will he not cause to prosper all my help and my desire? But the godless are all like thorns that are thrown away, for they cannot be picked up with the hand. To touch them, one uses an iron bar or the shaft of a spear, and they are entirely consumed in the fire of the spot. The word of the Lord. Our gradual Psalm 132, page 647 in your liturgy. We will recite the psalm by alternate verses. Lord, remember David and all of the hardships he endured. I will not come under the roof of my house, nor climb up into my bed. Until I find a place for the Lord, a dwelling for the mighty one of Jacob. Let us go to God's dwelling place. Let us fall upon our knees before his footstool. Let your priests be clothed with righteousness. Let your faithful people sing with joy. Together. For your servant is David's sake. Do not put away the face of your anointed.
The Lord has sworn an oath to David. In truth, he will not break it.
Children, keep my commandments and my testimony that I shall teach them. Their children will sit upon the throne forever. This epistle. A reading from the Word of God written in Book of Revelation, chapter 1, reading verse 4. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come. And from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood and made us to be a kingdom priest, serving his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the cloud. Every eye will see him. Even those who pierced him, and on his account all the tribes of the earth will wait. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, and who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. The word of the Lord. Our sequence in CPWI 251, Hail to the Lord Anointed.
Jesus answered, Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me? Pilate replied, I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done? Jesus answered, My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here. Pilate asked him, So you are a king? Jesus answered, You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise
God. Let us pray. With the words of my mouth and meditations of all our hearts, we now know we are not suffering in your sight, O Lord, our strength and Redeemer. Amen. Be seated. On this feast of Christ the King, the Church has given us an opportunity to hear this part of the Gospel of John independently of its association with the reading of the Passion and Good Friday. Jesus is before Pontius Pilate in the first of two sessions of interrogation that he had with him. The Jews want him condemned to death, but they cannot pronounce the death sentence for themselves. They are also having trouble coming up with the charges that demand capital punishment. And so they sent him before Pilate, accusing him of claiming to be the king of the Jews. And this is their strategic move, because anyone claiming to be a king, as long as Caesar is around, would be in trouble. Because for the Romans, that is a capital offense, and that is grounds for execution. It is a crime against the state. But Pilate's attitude is one of contempt and skepticism. This incident that he had to deal with is just another nuisance. The accused is a Jew. Why can't they deal with their own people? He wants to get it over and done with. So standing before him at that moment, Jesus does not look anything like a king. He had been arrested the night before. He was beaten, he was slapped in the face, he was spit upon, his hands were bound. More than likely, he would not have been well taken care of, he would not have been fed. He would have been disheveled and dirty. This is the King of the Jews. Where is his kingdom? Who are his subjects? In the Old Testament, when the people of Israel asked for a king, God tried to dissuade them, tried to discourage them through the prophet Samuel. God was supposed to be their only king. God knew that their king would not be just and merciful in their dealings with the people, but He let them have their way. And God's fears proved to be true. And eventually, Israel and Judah's kings led the people into idolatry. And they were dominated and forced into exile by their more powerful neighbors. Most of their kings did not live up to what was expected of them. They failed as religious leaders who were supposed to keep God's covenant and who were supposed to direct that the people keep it and were faithful to God as well. They failed to be the king that God wanted as rulers over his people. Of course, they had the outward appearance of kings. They wore the crowns. They sat on the thrones. They were clothed in purple and other kinds of fine clothing. They were rich. They had subjects. They held scepters in their hands and lived in palaces. But their hearts had strayed from God and from keeping his covenant. They had dethroned God as their king. Jesus had none of these kingly accompaniments when he came into this world. Born in a stable, surrounded by cattle, a manger for his cradle, having to work as a carpenter in his youth, no servants, poor, and living in one of the most obscure and insignificant villages of the region. He had none of these flashy displays of pomp and fanfare. Even when he rode triumphantly into Jerusalem, it was on a donkey and not on a horse. Jesus had no plans to overthrow the Romans. He had no armies, and no one was fighting to release him from captivity at the hands of the Jews. So I suppose it's no wonder that Pilate and others did not recognize his kingship. Yet, throughout his ministry, Jesus spoke of the kingdom which he had come to usher in, and of which he wanted us, his followers, to be a part, the kingdom of God. And his presence on earth meant that that kingdom was among us. But he also stressed that there was a huge difference between the kingdom of earth and the kingdom of God. The standards would be different. In some cases, they will be opposite to each other. The values that apply to the heavenly kingdom would be in direct contrast to those on earth. This heavenly kingdom would be a kingdom where justice, righteousness, and peace would reign eternally. It would not be established by succession, election, or conquest. The issues of plain earthly kingdoms would be irrelevant. Issues such as who would be a suitable heir to the throne. There would be no threat, no challenges. There is no fear of being overthrown by some usurper trying to seize power. These are what earthly kings have to worry about. And this was Herod's concern when he found out about Jesus' birth. And now Pilate had to worry about it too, because any threat to Caesar's rule had to be put down, or Pilate himself would be held responsible, and he could lose his position or even his life. Are you the king of the Jews? Pilate asked Jesus. Jesus responds to the question of his own. Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me? In other words, do you truly want to know if I'm a king? Do you recognize my kingship? Or do you just want to know whether their accusations are correct? Are you prepared to accept and believe the truth of my answer? If you cannot or will not accept the truth, telling you what it is will not convince you. Pontius Pilate did not care about Jewish customs, as long as they did not go against the authority of Rome and Caesar. Once he determined that Jesus was not a threat, it did not matter to him where his kingdom was or who his subjects were. He was not his king. What matters now is whether he is your king and my king, whether we recognize him as king of the world, king of our hearts, and are prepared and willing to allow him to rule them without competition from anyone or anything else, either within us or without. What matters is whether we can truly be called his loyal subjects, who will join his army and fight for him and for his kingdom. Not with violence or hostility, but with justice, mercy, and love. Jesus, our King, wants to lead his army against forces that cannot be defeated with guns and bombs and bloodshed, but with grace and patience, tolerance, prayer, faith, and perseverance by the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, our King, wants to rule in the castle of our hearts. If we continue to be his loyal subjects, eventually we too will inherit the kingdom that is not of this world. How many of us here have a chance to become heirs of any kingdom here on earth? In Western civilization today, the relevance of the monarchies seem to be diminishing. Many of them are simply ceremonial and have little executive power to govern. There is ongoing debate about their sustainability and their relevance. Some wonder whether they should be abolished. The kingdom of God will never lose its relevance, and in time it will become the only kingdom that still exists, and Jesus will reign over all. Jesus spent his life teaching us about this kingdom and the values necessary to inherit it. As followers of Jesus and as potential inheritors, this is how we should spend our life, learning and internalizing what Jesus has taught and training to be citizens of the kingdom. And it will take us our entire life to learn how to be members of this kingdom. Why? Because the values of God's kingdom are so different to the values of earthly kingdom that it is here on earth that we will learn how to choose those values over the values of the world. We may not be kings and queens in physical palaces, but sometimes we are quite capable of creating around and within us our own little kingdoms, and we are quite capable of ruling them by our own laws and our own statutes. But the laws and the statutes we should be always governed by are God's laws and God's statutes. Pilate asks, "Are you the King of the Jews?" And today we ask, "Is Jesus King of your life? Does he rule your heart? Do you recognize his sovereignty?" And if you can truthfully answer yes to all of your above questions, then you will inherit the kingdom that has prepared for us by our Heavenly Father. I send these words to you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And so let us stand in the firm of faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed of page 106. I believe in God, Father Almighty. Thank you. the opportunity and prayer. We thank God for another year of life, the time to stay at home. We pray for healing, for food, secret, and ability. And today we remember the case of the prophet Nadia, Sariah, and Darwin Samuel. We are still a grant of them alone, and like the curtain will shine upon them. May they and the faithful departed to the mercy of God rest in peace. We continue our procession using form B on page 107. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We pray thee for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our needs and those of others. In us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Using form A, let us therefore confess our sins. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and one another. In thought, word, and deed, we are worthy of death and death. We are sorry and repent of all our sins. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us for all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, in the glory of your name. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The greeting of peace for me. We are the body of Christ. By the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, and have all been made to drink of the one Spirit. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other a gesture of peace.
CPWI 378-370 for worship the King, all glorious above.
your servants, to pray for the work of your church and our mission in the world. Make us mindful of those who are without and cannot give, so that we can be a blessing to them as we seek to do your will. Accept the gifts of your people and teach us how to use them for the sake of your kingdom. This we ask through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Church of Christ, of which we are members, has taken this bread and wine and given thanks according to the Lord's command. We now share together in the communion of his body and blood. As our Savior has taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Save us from the final fire and deliver us from evil.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. The gifts of God for the people of God. You are invited to come and receive your Holy Communion. Please remember to sanitize your hands before kindly following the direction of the ushers. When you get to the top marker, extend your hands fully, then go either to the right or left, remove your mask and consume the sacrament.
Our communion hymn is CPWI 607-607, Lord enthroned in heavenly splendor, during which we have our second collection.
Page 148.
Jesus.
bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To go now in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
To enjoy the blessed wedding.
Thank you.